Know the deal. Thank you.
Don't have me do an attitude check in this place. Hallelujah. That's right. That's right. That's right. Y'all outnumbered tonight. Job chapter 2. Before y'all get mad. So good to see y'all. Job chapter 2. I'm reading verses 1 through 10. But before I read, I thank God for his son, Jesus, who is so evident in my life. Amen. Hallelujah. I can't speak for y'all, but he's evident in my life. Amen. I thank God for my wife who's serving on the door tonight. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. If y'all see her smiling, it's because we had date night last night. Amen. Mind your business. That's all you need to know. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. All I'm saying is she's still smiling. Job chapter 2. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. I'm smiling too. I'm a shout right by myself. Job chapter 2. Musicians, y'all the bomb. Thank y'all. In spite of all the adversities, technicalities that were going on, we still made it. Hallelujah. Amen. Job chapter 2. Job chapter 2. Amen. Verses 1 through 10. Y'all ready? If you need some more time, say, hold on, preacher. Okay, here we go. Job chapter 2. I'm reading from New King James Version. Amen. I don't know if I said give a praise for restored worship, but they stored up my soul on today. Can y'all help me? Can y'all help me? I mean, these are some young folk. These are some young folk that I really believe have a heart for the Lord. Amen. What you just saw in here today, it's not just show whenever the camera comes on. This happens in rehearsal. Amen. That's why it's so easy to flow when they get up here. Amen. I thank God for you all. Job chapter 2. Here we go. Verse number 1, it says, again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said to Satan, from where do you come? Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth, and from walking back and forth on it. Verse 3, then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. And he still holds fast to his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him without cause. Number 4, so Satan answered the Lord and said, skin for skin, or other words, everything. Yes, all that a man has, he would give for his life. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, he is in your hand, but watch this, spare his life. Four more verses. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with painful boils from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took for himself a potsherd with which to scrape himself while he sat in the midst of the ashes. Last two verses. Then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die. But he said to her, you speak as one of the foolish women speaks. Shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? And all this Job did not sin with his lips. I want to back up to verse 9 one more time. Then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die. Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Amen. I want to speak briefly from a subject tonight that simply says it ain't gonna happen. Hallelujah. It ain't gonna happen. Now I know where I'm at. I can say it that way. It ain't gonna happen. But I live in Hope Mills now. And when I walk in the stores of Hope Mills and I talk to people, I have to talk proper. So for those that might be watching from Hope Mills and Fayetteville and the big city of Lillington, it's not going to happen. Is that better? Hallelujah. Give me a little bit of low and take off a little bit of high, Jordan, on this one, please, sir. A good while ago, watch this, a survey was released of a questionnaire that was sent out to church-going Christians in the United States, trying to figure out, Sister Mookie, which book of the Bible too much was most read by those who love the Lord. And the survey went out and came back, Aunt Jean, to suggest, as not surprised to many of us, that the most read book of the Bible is the book of Psalms. Did you guess that? amen, the book of Psalms, that we enjoy going to those Psalms that remind us of a God who is our refuge and our strength. Is that better? Does that sound muffled? Y'all good? Oh, good, good, good. Let's go. The book of Psalms reminds us of a God who is worthy to be praised, a God who is our light and our salvation, a God who is with us in the very valley of the shadow of death. And I would suggest to y'all that although the book of Psalms is probably the one that you read the most, the book of the Bible that you're most familiar with is the book of Job. For even if you've never read the book of Job in its entirety, I suggest to you that each and every saint of God at some point along life's journey walks in Job's shoes. At some point with your Bible-carrying, church-going self, will you have to deal with some unexplained tragedy, some unjustified struggles, some unforeseen sicknesses, and some undeserved evil? That each and every one of us at some point along life journey winds up in a place or we're lifting up our heads to heaven, not in praise, not in prayer, but rather, Sister Naya, completely and utterly disgusted, asking God one question. Why? Anybody ever been there? I mean, life puts us in places where we wind up scratching our head and trying to figure out how in the world would God allow us to go through something that you and I and God knows that we don't deserve. You may not know, but this book of Job is not the first book of your Bible, but it's the oldest book in the Bible. And that's appropriate because Job raises the oldest question of anyone who walks by faith. And that is, how can God allow bad stuff, bad things to happen to good people? How can an omnipotent and all-powerful God who is able to shape the world out of nothing not protect us and prevent us from going through evil and tragedy and struggles and suffering that we didn't even deserve? Hallelujah. Why is it that God doesn't keep us from some of the things that we ask God to keep us from? Hallelujah. How can God love us and allow us to struggle? Now, I know because I went to Vacation Bible School. I was in Sunday school. Amen. And I know in third grade in your Sunday school class, they taught you that we shouldn't ask God why. Don't you question God. Amen. But you didn't got to get out of high school and make your way through life and grow up as an adult and not reach some place where you simply came in asking God, Lord, why did you allow this to happen to me? We might as well be honest in here. It seems like, God, you could have prevented that one. And the book of Job, Brother Thomas, is disturbing to me for two very real reasons. Number one, is that you can't get out of chapter 1 and verse number 3 without hearing the religious resume of Job. Chapter 1, verse 3 says that Job is blameless, if I'm not mistaken. He's upright, he fears God, and he shuns evil. And even God brags on Job and says there's nobody like Job. Job loves the Lord. Job is faithful. Job is a witness. Job is the man that God wants other men to be like. There's no one like Job. And yet and still, watch this, Job loses everything. Y'all hear what I said? He loses everything. Now, the reason that ought to frighten all of us is because that means that Job was holier than you or me. And if Job, with his holiness, can lose everything and struggle and suffer in ways that just don't make sense, it seems to suggest, my brother and my sister, that you and I, no matter how holy we try to be and no matter how big our Bibles are and how much we love the Lord, we will go through some stuff that leave us scratching our head and wondering, how could God do this to me? Second thing that's so disturbing to me about the book of Job is that Job seemingly just can't catch a break. I mean, if you read it, if it's not one thing, yeah, it's another. And things in Job's life go from bad to worse. And somebody can wink at me right there and say, hey, I've been there and done that. Just when it looked like things can't get no worse, they do. And if you read how the story goes, one day God and the servants of God were gathered in the throne room of God, and Satan shows up. And let me pause parenthetically real fast and tell you that anytime God's people get together, you ought to just assume that Satan is somewhere in the midst, somewhere. Now, don't look down your row. Everybody look at me. Don't look behind you. But Satan shows up when God's people gather together. And God asks Satan, where you been? What you been doing? And can I give you Jonathan L. Pipkin translation of what Satan says? He said, just chilling, hanging out, doing what I do. Amen. And God says to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? God says, I want you to know there's nobody like Job. There's no one who trusts me like Job. And Satan says, yeah, but the only reason Job trusts you is because you put a protective hedge all around him. And Satan says, I double dog dare you. If you take your hand off of him and if you destroy the hedge of protection, I can make him curse you to your face. Y'all ever had somebody just want to try you? That's what Satan was doing. He was just trying you. And then God says, I'm willing to take that bet because I can trust Job. And I know that Job would never curse me to my face. So God releases Job into the hand of Satan and tells Satan, watch this. You can touch everything. Excuse me. Everything. But don't touch his body. Okay? And as you continue to read in chapter 1, you'll find that Job struggles and suffers through a threefold tragedy. First of all, he loses all of his possessions. The Bible says the sheep, the oxen, the donkeys, and the camels are all killed. And then look, the second tragedy, the servants who worked for Job got all killed by the enemy. And then to make matters worse, in a tragic accident of an unforeseen tornado just came out of nowhere, Job loses all 10 of his kids in one moment. And yet through all of that tragedy, Job still holds on to his faith. Hallelujah. For at the end of chapter 1, you'll find Job declaring, even though I lost all my possessions, and even though I lost my servants, and even though all my children have been killed, Job said, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He still holds on to his faith. Watch this, only for chapter 2 to come. And we find out, Sister Mar, it ain't even over yet. Satan shows back up to God. God says, Satan, where you been? Satan say, just chilling. Y'all remember Brother Man on the fourth floor? Fifth floor, yeah. Said, just chilling, doing what I do. God says, did you try Job? I told you Job wouldn't curse me to my face. I told you Job was faithful. I told you couldn't make Job give up on me. And Satan said, yeah, but that's because you told me I couldn't touch his body. But let me touch his bone and his flesh. Hallelujah. And he'll curse you to your face. God said, guess what? I'm willing to take that bet because I know Job. If God was a betting man, he'd say, I got my money on Job. Amen. If he scratched the lottery like some of y'all do, I ain't mad at you. Just pay you 10% if you win. I'll take it if other pastors too deep to take it. Hallelujah. We'll take it right here. Amen. But if God was a betting man, he put his money on Job. Job has a faith, watch this, that can't be shaken. So God said, go on, touch his body, but you can't take his life. Stay with me. I'm almost finished. The Bible said that Satan goes out and he afflicts Job with painful boils all over his flesh, all over his body from his feet to his head. And Job, watch this. After all that happened, Job has been pushed as much as a man can be pushed. I mean, tell somebody, it's only a limit to what I can take. Hallelujah. He lost his property. He lost his possessions. He lost his image in the community. He lost his kids. And now he's lost his health. Job is literally hanging on by a thread of faith. And in that moment, when he's trying to hold on, when he's trying to figure everything out, when he's trying, Jordan, to keep his mind right, that's when we're introduced to Sister Job. Yeah, we don't know her first name. We're just going to call her Sister Job. This is the only place where she show up in all of Scripture. She only speaks, Sister McCahan, one verse. But she says four words that will make her memorable for all of eternity. She looked at Job and said, "Curse God and die." That's what she said, y'all. His wife, his boo thing, his bae tells him, "You ought to curse God and die." She says, in essence, Job, you ought to just give up on God. You ought to stop holding on to your faith. You ought to stop pretending like God is still in control. Job, look at all the hell we've been through. Look at everything we lost. And look, you sitting out here in ashes with your religious self, and your body is sick as a dog, and here you are still having faith in God? Come on, you ought to give up on God and just die. Now, hold on. Before we shake our head at Sister Job, before we condemn her to the depths of hell, before we shake our head saying, "Lord, that's a shame. He should have married somebody else." Yeah, he should have married somebody else. May I remind us, watch this, that everything that Job suffered, Sister Job suffered. You don't understand? Watch this. She was the one that helped him build his business, and they lost it all. And those 10 children that were killed, yeah, she birthed each and every one of them. But the way Job's story is told, you're only given access to Job's pain. But you never really get an inside scoop into Sister Job's pain. Hallelujah. And let me pause real quick and preach right here and tell you that you got to be careful of judging how somebody responds to a painful situation when you really don't have the inside information as to all the pain they've been going through. Pastor, you can preach that right there. Okay, thank you. You can't judge how I handle it if you don't know what the it is. You don't know the nights I stayed up. You don't know how it's broken my heart. You don't know how it hurt me. And how dare you look down your nose at me when you really don't know everything that I've been through. Try not to preach too fast, but we don't know what she's been dealing with. But here's what we see. That for Sister Job, the idea of dying is greater than the thought of living. It's right here in the text. She says, "Death, Sister Monique, is better than living like this." Now, I'm no psychologist. My degree is not even in psychology, and I dare not make light of the complexities of suicidal thoughts. But I will tell you that there are some people that you know, even in church, who would tell you that life has gotten so bad that the thought of dying was a little bit better than the idea of living. Go and preach, Pastor Pipkin. And when you get to that place and when those thoughts begin to creep in your head, I would argue with you. Although I do not understand all the complexities of suicidal thoughts, I will tell you this, that I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt that voice is not the voice of God. That is not the Lord speaking into your life. Can I prove it to you in scripture real fast? Remember when Satan showed up the first time, Mother Thompson, he tells God, "Let me touch everything." Somebody say everything. And he'll curse you to your face. And when he shows up the second time, he says, "Let me touch his bone and his flesh." And he'll curse you to your face. Stay with me. Somebody say bone and flesh. Watch what Satan says. He says, "If you let me touch everything, he'll curse you. Then if you let me touch his bone and his flesh, he'll curse you. If you let me touch everything and his bone and his flesh, I guarantee he will curse you to your face. So God gives him permission, I'm trying to explain it, to touch everything and his bone and his flesh. That's everything, right? So what's one of the things that's part of everything that Job has? Not just his animals, not just his servants, not just his children. What's something that Job has that's part of everything that Satan can touch? Can I go to Family Feud? Survey says his wife. He says, let me touch his bone and his flesh. Yeah. Come on, Bible readers. What's bone of bone and flesh of flesh that man has according to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 23? Bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh is my wife. And she says, curse God. And when she says, curse God and die, she's advocating for Job to do what the devil said Job would do if he could touch everything and touch bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. Lex, this helped me out because for the longest time, I couldn't figure out why if Satan took everything, he ain't take her too. And the answer is because he needed somebody to whisper in Job's ear that you ought to curse God and die. Now, I would suggest to you that whenever you hear that voice whispering over the pages of your life, you can quickly identify that that is not the Lord. That's the enemy. It is the enemy that tells you you ought to lay down and die. It's the enemy that tells you your life is not worth living. It's the enemy that tells you you ought to give up on God. It's the enemy who tells you that God don't care about you. It's the enemy that tells you that things are never going to get better. It's the enemy who tells you not to get up and come to church because ain't no point in worshiping God. It's the enemy who tells you you ought not to pray because God ain't even listening. It's the enemy who tells you that God has forsaken you and abandoned you. That's not God. That's the voice of Satan telling you curse God and die. But I'm going to hasten on. Job looked back at his wife and said, boo, I love you, but that ain't going to happen. I can't give up on God. Not right now. I can't walk away from my faith in him. Watch this. I still trust him. Even though I lost everything, and I know it's gotten bad, and I know it didn't turn out the way I wanted it to, and I know God hasn't done everything I asked God to do, but baby, one thing I cannot do is give up on God. And my brother and my sister, the question that must be asked right here is, how can Job still have faith after everything he's going through? How do you still believe in God when all hell has broken loose in your life and things have gone from bad to worse, and you've been trusting God and still going through tragedy after tragedy and evil after evil and struggle after struggle? How do you still have faith in a moment like that? And for somebody here tonight, that's a mighty good question. That's why God brought you to church this evening, because you're either in or about to find yourself in a Job type situation. And when you get there, I don't want you to give up on God. And I don't want you to put a gun to your head. I don't want you to listen to the devil convince you that God has given up on you. I want you to hold on to God and know that no matter how bad it gets, that you got to hold on to your faith in God. So I can hear somebody online saying, Pastor, I don't know how you know I was watching online tonight, but you preaching to me right now. How do I have faith when I go through something like this? I got a couple minutes. Let me drop three quick things on you. Hallelujah. We're going to get out of here. Number one, I want to suggest to you that Job's faith, watch this, is in the reality of God and not in the rewards of righteousness. Stay with me. We're going to get deep tonight, y'all. This ain't kindergarten stuff tonight. Y'all ready? My faith is in the reality of God and not in the reward of righteousness. When Satan shows up to the Lord, watch this. Here's the argument that he makes. Satan suggests that the only reason Job believes in God is because Job has found the formula that works. Watch this, that when he's righteous, he's rewarded. Job has found out that if he does this, God will always do that. That if he obeys, God will bless him. If he worships, God will provide. If he prays, God will protect. If he does what you call him to do, he'll live a prosperous life. And what the devil argues, rightly so, he argues, he says, that's not faith. I told you it was going to get deep. Stay with me. That's not faith. That's cause and effect. Oh, okay, we coming. And that Job ain't walking by faith. Right now, Job was just walking by cause and effect. Because he knows that if I do this, God would do that. So here's what the devil says about Job. He says, God, this is what you are to do. Break the formula. Stop doing what Job expects you to do and watch Job curse you. In other words, let him pray and nothing change and watch him curse you. Let him worship and still struggle and watch him stop worshiping. Let Job live right and still wind up with wrong and watch him abandon your ways. Let him be careful and diligent in his work and still lose everything and watch how quickly he gives up on you. Let him live healthy and still get cancer and watch how he walks away. Because the devil understood that there are some people, what you call faith is really just causality. That you live by faith because you expect the Lord to do certain things when you've done certain things. That when I do this, God ought to do that. And when I pray, God ought to answer. When I serve, God ought to bless. When I worship, God ought to provide. And when I do right to others, even though I can't stand them, they ought to do right by me. That's cause and effect. That ain't faith. Amen. And the Lord breaks, Sister Kid, he breaks the formula. That Job lived right and still winds up with wrong. And so his wife comes to him, and this is what she basically says. Job, why are you still walking by faith when faith ain't even working? I mean, this formula is busted. We lived right and still lost everything. We came to church on a Saturday night and still struggled with hell. We took care of our bodies and we still ended up getting sick. We prayed over our children, and they were still taken away from us. We worked hard to make it to retirement and still didn't have no money at the end. In other words, we did everything right, and God didn't do what God should have done. So why are we still trying to walk by faith? Job looked back at her and said, woman, you're acting foolish. Let the church say foolish. Can I teach Bible before I preach real quick? The word foolish that Job uses is the same word used in Psalm 14 and in Psalm 53. And in Psalm 14 and 53, the word says, the fool says in his heart, there is no God. That word foolish is used to describe folk who have an atheistic mindset based on the realities that they've been through. That they've been through so many things and now they've come to the conclusion there must be no God. And so what Job says, he says this to his wife. He says, listen, what we've gone through, it might cause you to act like there is no God. Job said, but I know that regardless of what I walk in, regardless of what I've lost, and regardless of all the hell I've been through, there's one thing that you can't never convince me of. And that is that my God is not real. Job said, I know that no matter what I go through, my God is still on the throne of heaven. He still reigns over my life. He's still the God who is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Here's what Job says. Job says, watch this. I love it. He says, my faith was never in what was going on down here. My faith was that God was still up here. And as long as I know that there is a God, Job said, I'm gonna put my faith in him. As long as I know that God is still on the throne of eternity, I'm gonna put my trust in him. In other words, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, because I know that my strength comes from the Lord. Watch this. This is deep. I'm moving real fast. This ain't for everybody, but I got to make this point. Here's what Job says. Job said, I don't need God to do anything down here for me to believe that he's up there. Hallelujah. He doesn't have to deliver me for me to trust him. He doesn't have to bless me with riches for me to know he's all right. He don't have to keep me from cancer to know that he's still sovereign and omnipotent. He ain't got to keep me from all of that because I trust God because I know that he's real. So listen, this is what God's looking for. He's looking for some folk that's has some Shadrach faith, some Meshach faith, some a bad Negro, I mean a Bendigo faith, who can see the fire in the future and still tell Nebuchadnezzar, I know God is able. But watch this, if he don't deliver me, I still put my trust in him. And I just wonder, is there anybody in this place that has some but if not faith? What do you mean, preacher? If the Lord don't even do it, I still trust God. If the Lord doesn't bring me out, I still know that he's real. If the Lord don't answer the prayer the way I want him to answer it, I still trust God. Ooh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I gotta move. Amen. But don't let your faith be in the reward of righteousness, but rather in the reality of God. So, Sister Mika, my faith isn't that when the praises go up, the blessings come down. My faith is that when the praises go up, there's a God who receives it. My faith is not when I pray, God will answer. My faith is that when I pray, there's a God who's listening and he will do what he knows is best for me. My faith is in God, amen, and not in what I'm going through. Job says, listen, I can hold on because my faith is in the reality of God and not in the reward of righteousness. I got to move. The second reason Job said, I hold on to faith. We got to hurry up. He says, I can have faith in God because I know the reign of God is greater than the rule of evil. The reign of God is greater than the rule of evil. Now, I understand that what I'm about to argue and suggest to you, that some of you may adamantly disagree. And that's all right, because my job as a pastor is not to make you think what I think. My job is just to make sure that you're thinking. And you can absolutely think differently than I am on this situation. We can have a debate about it. You'll probably lose, but we can argue this all day. But notice, the Bible says at the end of chapter 1 that with everything that happened, Job never charged God with wrong. Job loses property and possessions, prestige and children, and he does not fault God. Because maybe Job, like your pastor, doesn't believe that all evil is the hand of God. That every tragedy is not God at work. That everything you go through is not necessarily the work or the will of God playing itself out in your life. Now you might disagree, but at least let me argue my case from Scripture. Look at how Job speaks to his wife in verse 10. He says to her, woman, shall we receive good from the Lord and not adversity? Stay with me. Shall we receive good from the Lord? And maybe your Bible says, and not evil. Shall we receive good from the Lord? And maybe your Bible says, and not deal with trouble. Shall we receive good from the Lord and not evil? Now notice, Mar, Job doesn't say, shall we not receive good and evil from the Lord? Notice what he gives God credit for and then what he doesn't. He says, good from the Lord and evil. Let me try it this way. He says, the good, I know where that came from. But the evil, Job says, I don't credit that to God. He said, because I realize in my theological understanding that some of the evil that I endure, I can't put that at the feet of God, because this cannot be God at work in my life. Job realizes that there is a very real presence of evil that is at work in our lives. That is not God's hand. Y'all stay with me. I'm almost done. This word evil that Job uses is a Hebrew word that simply is ra, R-A. And when you see the word ra, it literally is referencing to something which is contrary to the plan of God. It goes against the plan of God. Ra evil is not God at work. Ra evil is Satan moving on the hearts of men and women. As a matter of fact, you see it in the Noah story when God looks out at the sons of humanity and realizes that they were ra. They were wicked. They were evil, and they are working contrary to God's plan. So God cleanses the earth because the raw evil is not according to the plan he had established in the Garden of Eden. When you see that evil in the Bible, it's something that is contrary to the hand of God. And Job says, this is not God. Now hear me clearly. Watch this. God can use things to grow us that don't make us feel good. That's not what I'm saying. But it always brings God glory when that happens. So the trials that make me strong, that's God. Storm that redirect the direction I'm going in, that's God. Closed doors that I can't open, keeping me from getting into something I ain't got no business being in, that's God. A thorn in the flesh that makes me pray to God, that's God. But Job says there's some evil I can't say that's God. That when innocent lives are destroyed, I can't credit God with that. When gunmen walk in and shoot up schools, I can't say that's God. When girls and women are raped, I don't put that in the hand of God. When children are molested and kidnapped, we know that's not God. When innocent lives are being destroyed by tragedy, we can't put that on God. But I realize that there is a very real evil that is at work in the world, an evil that shows its head in the Garden of Eden, an evil that Jesus says come to steal, kill, and destroy, an evil that Peter says walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, an evil that Paul says we wrestle against, and it's not flesh and blood, but it's principalities and powers and rulers of wickedness on this earth, an evil that seeks to blind our eyes to the glory of God, an evil that perverts the plan of God. There is a true evil at work. And that's the bad news. But here's the good news. Y'all ready? Get your amen button out. Here we go. The good news is that evil may rule, but our God reigns. Hallelujah. Testing one. Did you cut me off? Testing one, two. Can I try that one more time? Evil may rule, but our God reigns. In other words, evil shows itself for a season, but God reigns for eternity. Hallelujah. Evil may hurt for a while, but God ultimately always has the last justice and judgment. Our God always reigns. And I'm winding up. Can I just preach Bible for a quick minute? That's why I like the way your Bible ends. Your Bible ends with a book called Revelation. And do me a favor. When you read Revelation, don't read it trying to figure out when the world is going to come to an end, because you missed the message of Revelation. Don't read it trying to figure out who the Antichrist is, because you missed the whole message of Revelation. Don't read it trying to figure out the four horsemen of the apocalypse, because you missed the message of the Revelation. The message of the Revelation is simply this, that one glad morning, when it's all over, said, and done, that evil will no longer rule, but God shall reign for all of eternity. And I wish I had some people that can praise God right there. That our God reigns, and that our God is greater. That our God is able to correct all evil, even if we don't see it in our lifetime. Watch this. I got to teach this real quick. I want to preach out. God ain't worried, watch this, about proving his justice in your lifetime. God works through all of eternity. And God is bigger than the evil we deal with on this earth. I gotta leave you. His faith is in the reality of God and not the reward of righteousness. His praise understands, hallelujah, that the reign of God is greater than the rule of evil. But let me give you the last thing I see about my brother Job and how he keeps his faith in God. This is the last one. Y'all ready? And we're getting out of here, I promise you. He remembers that the goodness of God is a reason to trust God. In other words, he literally understands that what God has done in my past makes me trust him in my present and gives me even more hope for my future. That when I can't see him today, hallelujah, and I don't know what tomorrow gonna look like, God has been so good that I can go back like we used to when we had cassette tapes, and we can just press rewind and press play again and see how good God has been to me. Can I go on and preach this on out? The Bible said he looks at his wife. He says, I know we lost a lot today, but God's been good to us. I know everything ain't the way we want it right now, but God's still been good to us. I know looking at today in this moment that you can't see God at work in your life, but I dare you to just rewind the pages of yesterday and take a walk down memory lane. And I dare you to remember the ways God made. I dare you to remember all the doors that God opened, the blessings God provided, the ways he carries you through. Is there anybody in this place on a Saturday night who remember what he did last Friday? And you can declare without a shadow of a doubt that God's been good to me. So good to me. The Lord's made ways for me. The Lord showed himself strong for me. And if there's anything that I know, is that if God did it way back then, I can trust God that he's able. I said he's able to mass rewind and do it all over again. Would you tell somebody that's sitting close to your space, say, neighbor, I know without a shadow of doubt, baby, he can do it again. 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 Somebody in here sitting in restoration of Praise Ministries on a Saturday night wondering, how do I know the Lord will do it again? How do I know the Lord will make a way? How do I know God's gonna bring me out of my situation? Look at somebody dead in the face and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, I know he can do it because he's done it before. Woo. And my brother Ty Tribbett, all the way down in Orlando, Florida, he had a song that said, if he did it before, whoa, he can do it again. Same God right now. It's the same God back. I dare you to say, he's able, he's able, he's able. Do I have about 5 witnesses that when I think of the goodness of Jesus Christ, when I think about how good he's been, I know that God will do it again. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, he'll do it again. He'll do it again. Just open up your mouth and believe God that he will do it again. Tell somebody, it ain't gonna happen. It ain't gonna happen. I'm not turning my back. It ain't gonna happen. I'm not giving up on God. It ain't gonna happen because I've seen him work the miracle time and time again. Hallelujah. Glory, glory. I'm finished. But I just need about 2 or 3 folk that know God has done some things in your life. I don't need the whole church. I need about 2 or 3 folk that can lift up your hands, that can lift up your head, open up your mouth, and say, I thank God for everything that he did for me yesterday. But I believe God for every promise. I believe God for every promise that's going to take me into my tomorrow. If you believe it, baby, you ought to clap your hands and put a praise on it right there. You will walk the stage early with a degree. In Jesus' name. There will be promotions on the job. In Jesus' name. As a matter of fact, God gonna move some folk out the way in order for you to take your next step. In Jesus' name. There will be glory after this. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I'm through. If you receive the promises of God, go ahead and clap your hands right there. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. I believe it. I just dare you open your mouth and say, I believe. Come on, say it convincingly. I believe. Hallelujah. John Key had a song, I believe just what he said. Hallelujah. I believe. I'm at my mansion now. Tell somebody, I'm there right now. Baby, you might can't see it, but I'm there right now. Now jump behind and say, I believe. Just what he said. I'm done. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I believe it. He's done too much for me to turn my back on him now. I've got too many promises still out there for me to die and quit on God now. Hallelujah. I remember having COVID. Y'all can sit down. I'm done preaching. I ain't never been so sick in my life. The first time I got it, the Lord delivered me twice. First time I got it, I ain't never been so sick in my life. And my wife will tell you, I've had some sick days, but I ain't never felt like that before. When I left out the house, I sent a text to my children because I didn't know if I was coming back home. I sent a text to them. Tell them I love them. I'm proud of them. I told my wife before they took me, I love you. I ain't know if I was coming back. Hallelujah. But I got back there in that back room. And I began to call on God. Sick. I couldn't even muster out the words. But y'all know when they tell us that the Lord knows your heart. I believe God heard every word that I was trying to speak. The Bible said when you can't pray for yourself, the Holy Spirit will intercede on your behalf. And I believe it was some angels praying on my behalf. And I messed around and came to myself, Monique, and I said, self, you got too much work to do to lay on this bed and die. You got too much work to do to lay on this bed of affliction and not go back home. You got too much work to do. You got kids to raise. You got a wife to look after. You got God's people. You got too much work to do to not leave out of this hospital. And I believe when I prayed that prayer, the angels begin to shake that stuff. The COVID begin to loose my body. And I'm here to tell you the Holy Spirit showed me what the devil tried to take me out with. God brought me back home the same night. Don't tell me my God can't do it. Don't tell me God won't lift you up off your bed of affliction and bring you back home and restore you. And I know if he did it before, he can do it again. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just one of the crazy ones to quote the old whining song that said millions didn't make it. But I thank God I'm one of the ones who did. Hallelujah. Y'all don't understand. 2 years ago, y'all could have been having my funeral over at the Cape Fear headquarters building. Y'all don't understand. 2 years ago, amen, the Lord could have took me out of here. But I'm so grateful, hallelujah, that I had enough spirit in my body, even though I couldn't get it off my lip to say it ain't gonna happen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, don't get it twisted. Had it been the will of God for me to leave, I'd have been ready in my spirit. But I ain't gonna stand here and tell y'all I'm ready to leave. As much as I love the Lord, I ain't ready to go see him now. I want to see these babies grow up. Well, they're not babies no more, but only one of them. Amen. But I want to see them. I want to see the business come into fruition. I want to see the ministry grow. God, I got too much to do. And I dare you, the next time, and I'm trying to hasten on, but the next time you in trouble, talk to God and say, God, I got too much to do than to fall into this trap of Satan. Hallelujah. Listen. Every head bowed and eye closed real fast.